Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in to this Enabling Change and Innovation webinar. In just a moment, we'll be hearing from today's guest presenter, who is an Associate Professor in the Knowledge, Technology and Innovation Group at Wageningen University. And of course, that's over in the Netherlands. He has written many academic papers and presented at numerous conferences about agricultural innovation systems. In fact, I had the pleasure of meeting him recently in Christchurch at the APEN conference, and I know a number of the people on the webinar today were also there. So ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Laurens Klerkx to our webinar today to talk with us about using an innovation systems approach to achieve remarkable change. So Laurens, over to you. We look forward to your presentation today.
Yes, thank you, John. Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon in Australia. I indeed have a slight accent, so I hope you can understand it. If you wish, I can always speak in a French accent as well, but I won't do that because that's even harder to understand. So today I will talk about the innovation systems approach. It won't be a very theoretical talk. I'll go very quickly to an example, and hopefully that will be useful for you to relate it to your own practices and see what this innovation systems approach can mean for you. So, to start with, what is innovation? Innovation scholars have been looking at the process of innovation now for a long time, and they've discovered that innovation goes far beyond research and inventions. And I think that's an important thing to understand when talking about innovation systems. Innovation systems thinking really considers innovation to go beyond good ideas, inventions, R&D. Innovation systems thinking really considers innovation as a puzzle which involves many people, a lot of hard work, a lot of uncertainties to be solved at different levels, not only technological uncertainties but also social uncertainties, organizational uncertainties. How do you have to solve issues in the value chain? It goes far beyond the farm level. So innovation in the innovation systems perspective is really about social, institutional and organizational restructuring of the farm, but also beyond the farm. That's an important thing to have in mind when talking about innovation systems. So broadly, to set the scene for this talk, I will now discuss four subsequent perspectives in the thinking about innovation, because I think that innovation as we see it now has been done already for a time, but we haven't seen it, we haven't conceptualized it as such. And I think now we have arrived at quite a broad and complete understanding of what innovation is and how to best support it. So there are four perspectives I will briefly talk about. One is the diffusion and adoption perspective. Then I will talk briefly about the farming systems research perspective. Then I'll go to the agriculture knowledge information system perspective. And then lastly, I will talk about the AS perspective. Actually, I won't talk about them subsequently, but I will address them in a comparative table, which I will show now. So, if you look at these different ways of thinking about innovation, first approach, which I guess you are quite familiar with in Australia, because in Australia, when talking about innovation, often people talk about adoption of innovation, that is the diffusion and adoption paradigm. And that has been central since the 1960s, and that's mainly about supplying technologies through a pipeline. And as you can see in the table, in the farming systems, the AKS and the AIS approach, this mental model has really gone from a supply-driven model, thinking about research as the source of all technology, towards various actors contributing to innovation. And so you see that in the move from the 60s till now, you see that we have gone from really a supply-driven approach to innovation towards a co-development approach to innovation. If you look also at how knowledge is considered in innovation, you can see that in the diffusion and adoption perspective, often it's about a single discipline which makes a certain invention which then needs to be brought to farmers by extension, and that has been contested about is that really how things happen, how things should happen. And now we think much more about different disciplines and different bodies of knowledge which matter. So it's about the researcher's knowledge which is important. It's about the farmer's knowledge, which is important, but also all the advisors around the farmer are important. They have certain relevant knowledge. Also the policymakers in the rural areas, they have certain relevant knowledge. So we've really moved in this AIS perspective towards what they call a transdisciplinary perspective, various scientific disciplines, but also stakeholders' knowledge, and really a holistic perspective. So if you look at the drivers in the diffusion and adoption perspective, this is mainly about the supply push from research. Research is the source of all goods, that's where the action happens. The innovations are cooked in the kitchen of research and then are brought to the clients who are waiting in the restaurant to consume it. Well, we found out that there are many other factors that need to be brought into place for adoption to occur, and it's not just a decision only made by the farmer. It also requires adaptations in the context of the farmers. So in the AIS, it's really about that the whole system needs to be responsive to changes in context, and context need to be adapted to enable innovation. So that's an important change in the thinking which we have experienced over the years. So if you look at the relations with the policy environment, in the diffusion and adoption literature, science is seen as something independent. Innovations are made, as I said, in the laboratory, cooked in the kitchen of research. And institutional factors are external conditioners of adoption. They make it more or less attractive for a farmer to adopt an innovation. But in the AIS perspective, this context is seen as part of the innovation process, so something that should be actively worked on, and that's the main difference. So if you look at the roles of science, it has moved from being the principal innovator towards more an expert in the farming systems perspective, towards a collaborator in the AIS perspective, and now it's really one of the many partners in innovation processes, because, for example, a principal difference between AIS and AIS is that, well, AIS also had a systems perspective, but mainly the systems of farmers, research, and extension, the RD&E plus farmers interacting, and AIS is everybody in the value chain and the policy environment that needs to interact for innovation. So I think a very important one is the role of the farmers. In the diffusion and adoption literature, they're often seen as either adopters or laggards. Their role has become much more active, from sources of information to experimenters, and now they're really partners in innovation process, and also entrepreneur and innovators who sometimes take the lead in innovation process. I think it's important to move away from just seeing farmers as adopters or laggards, because a farmer which is a laggard in a certain area can be an innovator in another area. For example, I think that many farmers from organic agriculture have been seen as laggards in some time, and now they are the innovators because they have been doing their own research and their own experimentation with more environmentally friendly ways of doing agriculture. So I think this is an important move in the thinking. So you see also that innovation takes place increasingly in networks of actors. It's not a pipeline approach anymore. It's co-innovation, simultaneous work on innovation of different categories of people. And it's really about creating this broader institutional change, creating innovation capacity, not just changing farmers' behaviors. And so the intended outcomes go from technology adoption or uptake to really create innovation capacity in the rural areas. That's the main goal of innovation systems thinking. So what is important within the innovation systems approach is that the full chain needs to be considered and interaction needs to be created throughout the full chain in the different stages of the innovation process. And so really move from a pipeline approach to a network approach. That doesn't mean that in all stages of innovation development and broader diffusion, all actors need to play an active role, but they need to be involved in some way, also to anticipate upon the changes they need to make in their environment to make innovation work. Okay, questions and comments. John, I give the word to you.
Okay, thank you, Laurens. So you've done a really good job at painting some of the historical perspective, I guess, of where we've moved from the old diffusion of innovations model through to the current way of thinking. A question's come in from one of our audience members about how the AIS compares or differs from the agrarian systems concept that's part of the compared agriculture perspective that was developed in France. Are you familiar with that and can tell us a bit about that?
Well, I'm not exactly familiar with that concept, but what is important to consider, I gave four categories, I gave four ways of thinking. These are kind of meta-narratives, but of course other perspectives exist, and also these meta-narratives or the meta-approaches have been fed in by other approaches. You have participatory technology development, participatory research, you have induced innovation approaches. So there are all kinds of other approaches which have contributed to creating these meta-perspectives. So I'm not familiar with the agrarian perspective or agrarian system perspective, but yes, there are other perspectives which also float around, and sometimes they have distinctive features, sometimes they're basically the same as these perspectives, but of course this is a choice, this is an analytical choice we've made to use these four concepts.
Okay, thanks Laurens. Do you think that the idea of the transfer of technology has become defunct, or does it still have a place within we work?
It definitely still has a place, definitely. There's nothing wrong with it as long as you apply it in the right circumstances. If the context is already fit to accommodate certain changes at farm level, you can use a diffusion and adoption perspective, because mainly then it's about informing the farmer about risks, pros and cons. It needs to be visible, it needs to be triable, then it will work and farmers will adopt. But if you need more radical changes in the system, often it's not adequate because you need to work on so much more things than only fostering behavior change from the farmer. I think many people are familiar with the fact that there's a perfectly good technology which is not being adopted, and then people say, well, these farmers, they're not rational. No, they're actually very rational because it just doesn't fit their context. Sometimes a regulatory issue doesn't make it attractive to them to adopt. So then you need to work on the regulatory issue and not just put in more information on the technology to make the farmer adopt. But definitely it still has a place. For example, the adopt model, which is now being used to predict adoption, I think that can still be also a very, very valuable tool to see what are the contextual factors we need to work on to enhance adoption. Which lie outside the farm level. So adoption thinking definitely still has a place.
Excellent. Okay, well, thanks, Laurens. You've covered the questions that are relevant so far, and I'll hold off some of the others because I know that they refer to later in your presentation. So let's move on into your presentation, please.
Okay, I'll do that. You're welcome. Okay, so I think what has become clear from the comparison, or at least I hope it has become clear, that the AIIS approach really emphasizes broad networking for innovation. And this broad networking for innovation is not easy at all, because you need to find the right partners. You need to know with whom to collaborate, and where are they, and who are the best partners to collaborate with. You need to find a common language and a common goal. Innovation always starts with a vision. You need to know where do you want to go to, especially when you have very difficult issues. If you have a system which has come at its limits, for example, in terms of productivity, in terms of its environmental impact, then sometimes you really radically need to change your vision and you need to reconfigure the whole system. And that's not easy to find such a common vision and also find then the right configuration of the network to work on change. You need to arrange all kinds of formalities. You need to see how can we make investments for this innovation process. Who of the innovation network partners will make which investment? What will be the revenues? When can we expect revenues? How can we share the revenues? What about intellectual property? Also, innovation is a process which is not neutral. There are winners, there are losers, there are conflicts. People have different interests, people have different backgrounds in the network. A researcher thinks about different things, about different time horizons than a farmer. A researcher needs to make publications, a farmer needs to make profit. And sometimes those two drivers don't go well together, so there will be conflicts that need to be solved. And also, these networks, they need to be open in the beginning to tap into all kinds of different people and foster creativity, new ideas, but also they need to what they call close down a bit. They need to become formalized. People need to start trusting each other. That requires work on building such trust and building kind of a durable network. But at the same time, if that network becomes too inert and becomes too tightly woven, it also may lose creativity when new challenges emerge, and then you need to open up the network again. This balance is quite challenging. Well, to foster, and also talking about specific innovation system interventions, this networking for innovation, we've seen in the past years, at least in my country, a whole new breed of actors emerge within the knowledge infrastructure, so to say. So apart from research and extension, you've seen this breed of innovation brokers emerge, and which are basically professional facilitators, system facilitators. Of course, facilitation is not a new thing. It's done by extension, it's done by research, but often it's more at a watershed level or at a regional level. And these innovation brokers really look at the system level, and basically what they do is facilitate networks. So here on the right of your screen, you can see all kinds of organizations which have emerged as a separate organization to fulfill this enabling role. They're the spiders in the web of the innovation system. They need to form the web, but they also sometimes need to eat the bugs in the web to remove barriers to innovation. So what are their functions? Well, if you look at the right, you see a compass, you see kind of a constructor figure, and you see a person which has kind of a crystal ball. So their functions are helping to create visions, find the direction for innovation, articulate the demands, what is needed in terms of knowledge, technology, lobbying capacity, finance, to foster this innovation process. They help to construct the networks of people that are needed. And also they foster reflexivity of the networks. That means that these networks are being facilitated to think once in a while, where are we? Where should we go? Who should be involved? Do we have any conflict? Should we change direction? So they are really providing a mirror to the network participants. And they have, in this position, they have the role as catalysts of the innovation system. Any questions? John, to you.
Yes. So we acknowledge that you're using agriculture as the focus for today's presentation. Mm-hmm. One of the participants in our webinar actually works in the community services area and has made the comment that they can see the relevance to there. How widely spread is this innovation systems thinking? Like how wide, across how many disciplines does it go?
Well, innovation systems thinking is actually something which hasn't emerged only in agriculture. In fact, it has really moved into agriculture from other sectors. It's being applied increasingly, has been applied traditionally in industrial sectors, but also it's now increasingly applied to all kinds of transition challenges we have, including also community development, health systems development. So it's also applicable to other sectors.
Okay, thank you. On your slide where you had the spider web, you were talking about innovation brokers. So the question is, can individuals also be innovation brokers, or is that role or function only for organizations?
No. Definitely individuals can be innovation brokers. And in fact, you see many people who kind of naturally emerge in organizations fulfilling this role. And this is perfect, but it also has some disadvantages, because if you don't have it as your core identity and clearly position yourself as a broker in the system, and people might ignore your contribution, it might not fit with your job description, people might not reward you. So sometimes it's better to make it more visible and to more clearly present yourself as an innovation broker. But of course, any individual can fulfill these types of roles. In fact, it's kind of a professionalization, making independent this role of broker facilitator.
Now, Laurens, I know you've been out to New Zealand. Can you suggest examples of any well-known brokers in either New Zealand or Australian agriculture that we might perhaps be familiar with?
Oh, that's a difficult question. That's a very difficult question. I couldn't answer that easily. I know that, for example, in Australia, for a long time, there has been the land care movement. And I know that in land care movement, facilitation was key thing. So you could say that the land care organization, as far as it exists, could maybe be considered a type of innovation broker, as an example for Australia. And maybe, depending on how far they go with facilitation, I'm not sure about that, maybe organizations that they're in New Zealand, I don't think they are yet an innovation broker, but they could become it if they become more active also in brokering these networks of multiple actors, which they then also maybe fund to some extent.
Okay, so maybe we're yet to move into that stage.
Yes, maybe. Oh, yeah, or maybe there are organizations, but we don't know yet who they are and where they are. Huh? At least I don't know that.
So, Laurens, do you think in the future that there may be people who make a career out of being innovation brokers?
Yeah, definitely. What we've seen in the Netherlands is that some people have made a career out of it. They are usually people who are quite extrovert persons. They have a certain drive for system change. They sometimes also have become frustrated with the lack of impact of research. Some of them are frustrated researchers in a sense. And they have the personal qualities to become innovation brokers because they can relate to many different worlds. So these people, they have founded these organizations, and many of these organizations, which I showed in one of the slides, have been founded by these types of persons. They actually make a living out of it. It's not an easy task because this role, like I said, is quite intangible in the background. Huh? If you are the spark plug for a network and that network produces results after 5 years, I think very few people will remember it was you, the spark plug, who initiated all of this. So then your contribution is not easily recognized, and it also has consequences for funding. What we've seen that many of these organizations, they have a hard time surviving only on private funding, payments by their clients. As it is a collective function, it optimizes the system. I think that this also merits some kind of collective funding, and you see that most of the people who do this type of job, they have negotiated kind of a collective funding from different actors in their region or from a commodity board or from government, saying we have benefit for the system as a whole, so that's why we need your support.
Good. Okay, Laurens, I think it's best if we now move on to your next section, because I know you're going to talk us through a large case study, and I think that may answer some of the questions that have come in too.
Yeah. Okay, I will do that. Okay, so I will talk about a case in egg production. I assume that also you produce eggs in New Zealand and Australia. Maybe for the plant production sectors people, this is not really their daily work, but I think that nevertheless they can see some interesting things in it for them. So what is the starting point? This is quite a nasty picture. For those that joined early, this is definitely something different than the beautiful flowers John showed us. It's some nasty pictures of dead animals. But this is the starting point for this implementation of a new way of working in the Netherlands. So we've had a very good, in fact, linear system, a diffusion and adoption system from the Second World War onwards, or after the Second World War, till the 80s, which was really focused on the modernization of agriculture. So pushing in technology, pushing out laggard farmers, making bigger farms, highly technology-intensive farms, which is called factory farming by many. And that has some disadvantages. There's low animal welfare. You can see on the left bottom corner the hens in their tiny cages. We have a problem that we have nutrient pollution to our groundwater because we import the soy from Brazil, but we don't send the dung back to the Brazilian rainforest, or what was left from the Brazilian rainforest, the soy fields. We have problems with contagious disease. You can see several big machines lifting out pigs and goats, and you see a goat with a cross. That was because of all kinds of viruses and bacterial infections floating around, which spread easily because we have very concentrated animal production areas. Pig farmers or hog farmers are not allowed anymore in hospitals because they're always bearers of a multiple resistant bacteria who does not respond to antibiotics anymore because preventive antibiotic use has caused that bacteria do not longer respond to antibiotics. And we have, of course, the issue of climate change. The methane produced by our animals contributes to climate change. So we have our crisis. And that is actually the starting point for projects which have a system innovation approach. And here you see quite an abstract picture which captures the system approach. And this is basically about understanding how systems change. And systems, stable systems, which function well, like an intensive animal production system, they can be called a socio-technical regime. They're a whole set of practices, of scientific knowledge, of markets, of culture, which more or less are a stable thing. Actually, this factory farming, it worked quite well for a long time. But it has become unsustainable. But still, it's very hard to change this dominant design of factory farming, of intensive animal husbandry. But what you then see is that at the bottom, there are certain niches, and these niches, they are kind of innovation networks where learning takes place, where people are experimenting with new things, and they are in a constant battle with this regime. They are trying to reconfigure it. They're trying to change it. So they're trying to become the new dominant design, the new configuration, the new system. So this is actually about moving from one system to the other. This also takes long periods, from 20 to 30 years before these transitions really take place. And this happens under the banner of landscape developments. And landscape should not be taken as landscape in the physical sense, but this is really about all kinds of developments which take place. And if you take this example of intensive animal husbandry, for example, the increasing the satisfaction of the public with these types of production systems, they provide a window of opportunity for start changing it. Also, climate change debate, it's an opportunity for starting to change it. So these are these broad developments in the world which influence the transition towards a new regime. So what did government do? Because they also recognized this animal production system which we have, it's not sustainable. They said we need specific policies to stimulate radical innovation and to create niche projects. So to start working on experiments which might offer an alternative for these socio-technical regimes, these locked-in systems which are not sustainable. So what they did is that they helped in the creation of kind of redesigns of systems. And they did this by various instruments. So they funded R&D think about new systems and also to scientifically ground these new systems so that they were actually feasible and based on sound knowledge. They put the money into platforms and linkage building to build the networks to create these new visions, these new designs, and also execute them, implement them in practice. They subsidize this with all kinds of innovation subsidies for R&D, for experimentation, for also funding these platforms. And also because it always boils down to, does the consumer buy it? Is there a market for it? They also started to raise awareness among consumers about more sustainable products. In this case, for example, products which represent a higher animal welfare. So for this particular case which I will present, they applied the method of what they called interactive reflexes design. And this is actually something which was done by researchers from Wageningen Livestock Research. But they said, okay, if we really want to change the system, we should not just engage in problem solving, further optimizing the current system. We need to radically take a distance from the current system and think about, okay, what is the desired system? So here they followed kind of a new product development approach, which really starts with the demands of the consumer and what does that mean in terms of design characteristics. So they started with defining, okay, what are the key challenges? What does the system look like? What are future visions we need? And they translated that into briefs of requirements. So really, for all categories of participants, they try to quantify and make very explicit what are the requirements of the system for the public, for the farmer, for the chicken, what would they want from such a system. And then they really, in the second part, the structured design, they translated that into detailed proposals. And the idea was that these proposals, which consisted of these briefs of requirements, these these outlines of the different design requirements and also of all kinds of visualizations. They hoped that the sector would take this up and start working on realizing this, which is the third phase, anticipating niche and structural change, and really bring into practice, have these niche practices to start reconfiguring that regime. All very technical and theoretical, so now I'll show what it looks like. So here you have an example of a program of demand. It's in Dutch, but hey, you see that this is about the need of resting of the hands. So here they have defined it as executing rest and sleep behavior. They have specified the needs. Say they need sufficient space. They need to have a certain little sitting pole or whatever you call it. They have a certain day and night rhythm. You have to consider that. So what does that look like? What is the quantity? What is the source of scientific evidence? So they really unraveled all these different needs and demands, and they made them explicit and concrete. But they also made an artist impression. So in this case, they created a round system, which was called the rondel, which is kind of synonymous for a castle tower, because it had to show robustness of the system, a robust system, resilient system. And here you see that they try to capture all kinds of requirements from different parties. So it is a system at a family farm scale. You don't need external labor, because it's very important in the Netherlands. We have only generally family farms. It needs to be also indoor systems so that the chickens are protected against other birds to prevent diseases. But nonetheless, they need to go outside. So they also made this outside space here. So they try to combine intensive systems with free-range systems to get an optimal solution. So during the process, they invited all kinds of cartoonists to participate to also make drawings of the process in the creative sessions. And they translated all these different crazy cartoons, because here you see some chickens with a broom, for example, in this final design. So, okay, this was in a project which started in 2004 and ended in 2006. And the final results were these designs and these programs, these briefs of requirements. Okay, but what next? Here the research ended, and the idea was, okay, now the sector should take it up. So here you see that some firms took up the challenge and they formed a consortium. And here you see the importance of different qualifications, different competences. So here you have a firm called Vencomatic, which is an egg system producer or a husbandry system producer. And Quetters, they are a logistic firm who knows a lot about marketing and packing of eggs. And they took up the challenge. And these designs they had, which came out of research, and also these drawings, they gave them guidance where to go. And they really were very confident, and they were very determined that they would maintain this round form of the system, the flyer saucer type system, the Star Wars battle station form. They wanted to maintain it. They always said, we want to maintain the round form. But still, they had many uncertainties. How can we fit our current technologies within this new system? So that we don't have to do that many investments in new developments. Where do we get the money to fund this? They had some money, but they're small and medium enterprise, or medium enterprise don't have that much money. What about public policy? Government supported the first project, but will they also support this? What will the consumers do? Will they recognize that this egg has added animal welfare? Are they willing to pay more for it? Will the suppliers be able to provide all the goods to make the systems, also to make them work? Will the retailers, the supermarkets, will they be willing to buy this egg which the system will produce with added animal welfare? Because that's the key selling point. I hadn't said that explicit before. So they had many uncertainties which they couldn't solve themselves. Because they have well-qualified staff. They have highly educated people, university-level people. But they don't know everything. So there's also need for external resources and competences. So in terms of external capacities, they drew on several parties. So livestock research from Wageningen was involved for R&D, but also brokering. So what they mainly did, and that's maybe a different role of research, not just as the source of knowledge, but also assisting innovators in the process of really realizing new technologies and new systems, they did all kinds of other R&D tasks. So what they did a lot was scientific advice, had to check and verify certain options. They made authoritative calculations to help in the permit applications. And so they really had kind of an on-demand role in this process. But it was very important. For example, the system used existing technologies, and these existing technologies, they had been checked and they complied with environmental norms. Would they want to install this new system, they would also need to show this complies with environmental norms. Normally this takes 5 years to do the whole check and to comply with all the requirements. But with use of the results of assessments of Wageningen livestock research, it could show, well, although it's a new configuration, it has the same characteristics, and it's meant they could get it approved right away. So this meant a 5-year advantage. And also, the researchers, they did a lot of brokering. They helped make connections with municipalities who could be interested in building this system. And they really, with their legitimate positions as scientists, helped these innovators broadening their network. They also had a broker which was called Transition and Society. There was a person who knew a lot about corporate social responsibility, so he was very much aware of what different supermarkets want. He also had very good connections with different supermarkets in the whole of Europe. He also knew the Animal Welfare Protection Society very well, because also their support as an important representative of the citizens of the Netherlands, which are very critical about animal production systems. He helped them to get into all those different worlds, to make contacts with supermarkets, to make contacts with the animal welfare organization. And then there was this organization Transform, and it's really a broker organization. And what they did is they provided funding and brokering for 30 innovation projects, which were also very risky, and they had a high chance of failure. But Transform thought, well, failure is part of innovation, and so we'll fund it anyway. And what they did, they obliged all these networks, because they got substantial funding also for funding the R&D and the other facilitation work. They got substantial funding from Transform, so they said, okay, you get our funding, but you need to reflect every month on how this network is going. And this was very important, because this consortium of Quetters and Vancomatic, the two firms, at some stage, nothing happened for about a year. And why was that? That was because there was internal conflict within the Quetters Agpacker firm. The old generation in that forum of managers, they didn't see any future in this new approach. They said, we should just stick to our core business, pack eggs, not engage in these crazy projects. And the younger people said, no, this is the future. Animal welfare is a main issue. So they had an internal struggle, but didn't express that to the consortium. So nothing happened. And Vancomatic was thinking, you know, how should we continue? And then in such a workshop, they were forced to express this, and then they decided to withdraw from the consortium. Vancomatic bought all the rights. They formed a spin-off firm, and then there was a huge acceleration of the process again. So here you see that this reflexiveness in innovation network is very important. Otherwise, they may become stagnated or even die. What was also very important here, talking about new outputs for research, making very tangible and visible, okay, what should these new systems look like, was the visualization of the design. So they had these drawings, they had the briefs of requirements, had the design outlines, but they also made a scale model, they also made an animation, and this was hugely important to sell the story to all kinds of parties who they needed to support them. So they went with these scale models to local authorities and said, yes, this is great, innovative, we want to have this in a municipality, we'll help you with the permits. And they showed it to the minister, that's the lady on the left in the picture. And she also promised, I will urge my civil servants to do all they can to really make this happen. They went to farmers' organizations also to get their support. They went to the Animal Protection Society, to supermarkets, to farmers. And this really helped to draw all these people into the network. For example, what you see here at the right bottom, it's a certification of the Animal Protection Society with 3 stars, and it means that it has extremely high animal welfare, and having such a seal on your package, it helps selling your product to the consumer. So this was key, also this visualization, this object was key in really forming this network. And what was one important thing before I go to this picture is that what was very remarkable is that they first, Bencomatic as a firm which sells systems, they first saw farmers as clients that would buy the system. But because this was such a radical new idea, farmers were really, you know, hesitant. Maybe if you look at the adoption literature, you would clearly be able to point out why were they hesitant, because it was not that tangible, visible yet. But they still saw them as adopters, and this was a huge mistake, because these farmers said, yeah, we won't do anything until we are considered as co-developers. So at some stage, and it was also due to the facilitation of transformers, they started to see them as really co-developers. They also not thought about selling this. They also stopped thinking about just selling the system as a whole package, but really making a joint venture with farmers. So this was also a new role for farmers, not seeing them as adopters, but really as co-innovators. Well, a major issue in innovation is that different things are interdependent. This also has to do with this idea that technology goes together with organizational development, and that market goes together with system development. And the main problem was that they couldn't get funding to build the first system, because the problem was to get funding, they needed a contract from the retail, from the supermarkets, that they would buy the eggs from the system. But to get a contract from retail, they needed to have a system built. But because they did not have a contract from retail, they didn't get any funding from banks. So there was a vicious cycle. And nobody was able to invest so much money from these participating firms to really build the first system on their own. So they needed some kind of state support. But state support is very hard to get because the European Union doesn't allow it. So here you saw a clear problem also in terms of innovation support instruments. There's no risk funding or no guarantee schemes which help innovators realize their first real system, so moving from a prototype stage to a real system stage. So here you also saw the value of brokering, because together with these brokers, they continuously looked for other sources of funding. They insisted with the ministry, you know, don't you have some scheme that can support us? And finally, they found that an existing scheme had been broadened. There's a larger sum of money available to give guarantees to individual farmers for investment. And this allowed the money to build, this allowed the consortium to get a loan to build the system, because they got the guarantee from the state, and then the bank said, okay, now we have our collateral, so we'll give you the money. So this guarantee really paved the way, and here you see it's also very important to engage with public authorities to not see innovation just as technology. This was clearly an institutional issue, a funding issue, but the bank gave a loan, and here you see that this crazy design had this flying saucer, as you saw it on the little animation, it's there. It's there in reality. This is not a Photoshop picture. It is there. You see here that also all these design features, they are also embedded within this design. And because the construction of the first one deal happened, they could also negotiate a contract with these supermarkets for shelf space. And because they had engaged already many times before at an early stage with supermarkets, they knew about it and they said, okay, now we will commit. So they got a contract with the biggest retailer in the Netherlands. They made a very nice round box for it, also from sustainable materials. The NGOs, they were very enthusiastic also because they had the seal, but also the more radical NGOs, the ones that tend to paint assassin on the doors of farmers in pig blood, those radical types, they were enthusiastic. So there was all free publicity for this product. And there are now already three or four systems in the Netherlands. They're also expanding this product now to Germany and to Belgium. And there's a good prospect for it, because the cage systems have just been abolished in Europe. So farmers are looking for an alternative. So it's also a matter of timing. So I'm quite confident that this egg has a future. In fact, I recently flew with KLM, I ate a sandwich, I looked at the box of the sandwich, and what does it say? This sandwich is KLM is proud to present one bill egg. So they're also working on different types of markets. So, getting to the main lessons, because it has been quite a stretch me talking. Working from an agricultural innovations perspective, which is mainly recognizing the importance of networking and also bringing the instruments in place to support networking. The main lessons are that you need to focus on what they call co-evolution between hardware, software, and hardware. So technology always needs to go together with institutional developments, changing the rules of the games, changing organizational arrangements. That's the hardware. You can do that by tapping into the software, the knowledge of many different actors, not just extensionist knowledge, farmers' knowledge, or researchers' knowledge, but also from policymakers, civil society organizations, all kinds of other actors in the chain. You need to build a strong but an adaptive vision through interactive design. It's not about continuing with solving problems of the existing system, but it's also about radically defining where do we want to go and taking that kind of as a beacon in this uncertain process of searching. You need to build different interfaces. You need to make connections with maybe parties you're not familiar with or where there has been conflict in the past. I can imagine that also in Australia and New Zealand there might be some problems with NGOs and the farming sector. You need to mobilize and foster powerful, influential champions. This network, which I showed, they use science as a champion to help them opening doors. They also linked with the minister to get her on board as an influential champion of innovation. They also consistent in the firms themselves. They were acting as champions. They had very high enthusiasm. So you should really define who are my champions and how can I help them. We saw that the role of science is more as a designer, as an advisor, as a fact checker, and not just as the source of technologies. Also what you see here, that there are alliances of different advisors, and this is a key message for extension. I know that in Australia, at least, there is a move towards privatization. There are different types of advisors. Well, if you want to have these types of innovation, but I think also at the farm level for maybe less radical innovations, you need to make alliances of advisors, and it's important to stimulate it. And it's important to be reflective. You need to have reflection on where are we, where should we go, and you need some monitoring for that in these networks. Okay, what we also saw here is that this role of innovation brokers is quite important because really they help these networks to connect with the right persons. They mediate between different worlds. But this role is not easy, as I already said earlier, because of course you need to balance the demands from different parties, and you cannot just advocate for one party because then you're not legitimate anymore for the other. You need to maintain a certain neutrality, but of course that's not easy because sometimes also you need to kick some shins and annoy some people to get things moving, but not to such an extent that they don't want to work with you anymore. And like I said, this brokerage function is quite intangible, so it's hard to really show your contribution while you have an important contribution. And so this has implications for taking this function. It's an important function to take, but it's not important. It's not easy to explain to people what you're doing. Okay, this was it from my end. I hope it has been clarifying and interesting for you. And you can visit my academia.edu website if you want to see work related to this. There are two articles on this Rondale case. You can check them out. One is called Adaptive Management in Innovation Systems, and the other one has the word boundary objects in the title, so you can check it out. And I now give the word back to John for a final discussion and wrapping up this session. So thank you for your attention.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Laurens. We have a few questions. Well, we actually have a lot of questions, and I will pose a few of those to you. So if you can answer them as briefly as you can, please. So,
yes.
Number one, can government agencies, and particularly extension officers, be effective innovation brokers?
Yes, they can, as long as they take a distance from their normal roles. And an innovation broker is not an expert. You should not play the expert role. You should play the facilitator role. But they can, and they should also then communicate that they have a different role than they normally take. But I think they can.
Very good. Innovation brokers also boundary spanners?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, Brokering is one word for this work of spanning boundaries, making connections. There are lots of words. We choose the word innovation broker, but it's very similar to boundary spanner, boundary organization, definitely.
Good, thank you. In your case study, why were the suppliers and other important parties not involved at the start of the innovation process, but rather being introduced after the system had already been developed? Why was that?
No. Actually, many of the suppliers, they were not that well involved in the design process. There was also kind of a learning for these people that did the design process to do that more actively in subsequent projects, because they also did these projects for dairy, for goat farming. But they were quite involved in a quite early stage by the development consortium. So then they already started talking to, for example, greenhouse builders, because they have all kinds of construction methods which were useful. They started talking with milking carousel, milking robot developers, because they could use these carousels as a way to dry the dung, to have a lighter weight of the dung, to get it out of the system. So they did engage in an early stage with all kinds of suppliers.
Great. Okay, so on that note, I'm sorry, folks, I'll have to close off the questions because I do like to finish the webinars on time, and I just have a few announcements for our sponsors. So again, Laurens, thank you so much for getting up early this morning and for the great presentation that you gave to us. We've certainly appreciated that.
Okay.
Now, folks, instead of this webinar being a flash-in-the-pan type activity, please pop over to my blog so that you can continue the discussion afterwards. So within the next day or so, I'll send you an email with a link to the blog where you can find a recording of today's webinar. And also in that email, I'll share some of the resources that some of our webinar participants have been sharing with me through the chat box. So thanks for those who have been sending those through. Now, I also use User Voice, which allows us to nominate and vote on future webinar topics. So once you've completed the post-event survey that I'll email you, once you've completed the survey, it'll take you to this User Voice site so you can nominate and vote on future topics that will be of interest to you. Now, folks, today's webinar has been brought to you by a partnership between the Queensland Government, for whom I have the pleasure of working, APEN, which is the Professional Organisation for Extension in Australasia, and also Citrix GoToWebinar, who are subsidising the costs for our webinars that we've been delivering. And so just a quick word about APEN. So APEN is the Australasia Pacific Extension Network, and they help people who are interested in facilitating change in industries, communities, and the way that we manage our natural resources. So if that interests you, you can pop over to the website. Not only does APEN have a website, but you might like to check out our LinkedIn group, where you can share in discussions about topical issues and upcoming events, and you could also, of course, follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook. Our webinar partner, Citrix GoToWebinar, which we use today to power the webinar, are offering a free trial. So if you would like either the free trial of GoToWebinar or to get a subscription to GoToWebinar where you get the first 2 months free, please tick the appropriate boxes in the follow-up survey and make sure that you include your contact details so that they can actually follow up with you. Now, folks, we use SurveyMonkey to follow up our survey to find out what you thought, and the monkeys will be waiting to read your responses. And, of course, if you ask for the free trial, don't forget to include your contact details just once more. So, folks, that's all for today. Again, I'd like to thank Laurens for his presentation, and a big thank you for all our attendees from across Australia, New Zealand, and a couple overseas further as well. So thanks for coming along and interacting with us today. I look forward to seeing your comments and ideas over on the blog. So wishing you all the best until we meet again. Hooroo for now.